Hi, this is me, Sukrut. In this video, I'm going to tell you how to reverse hypothyroidism-induced pattern hair loss. Many people do not know, but low thyroid function can cause pattern-like hair loss. But if you look at the people's TSH values, they look absolutely in range. Today, I'm going to share with you what all I have learned about hypothyroidism-induced pattern hair loss and what you can do to stop and reverse it. I have studied many people over the last few years, but when it comes to thyroid problems, there are very few people I trust a lot more than the others. The first name which comes to my mind is of Dr. Reich Hemmer. He developed a new branch of medicine called German New Medicine. When it comes to his research, there are people on both ends of the spectrum. Those who are hardcore disbelievers, and on the other hand, there are people who are hardcore proponents and swear by his research and use it regularly in their practice. The problem I see with a lot of people who denounce his research is they haven't even bothered to test it in real life. Now, I have started studying the implication of his research and started to find that there's quite a lot of truth out there. He coined a term called Turk-Hammer syndrome and discovered 5 biological laws. They are especially developed in regards to cancer, but they also can be extended and used for explaining the cause of other chronic ailments too. He has worked tirelessly and fearlessly for more than 35 years to validate his research. He believed that brain, psyche, and organ are connected. If I interpret his research correctly, there are 2 phases of a disease, like in Ayurveda, hot phase and cold phase. Hypothyroid is a conflict resolution phase. Hyperthyroid is a conflict active phase. Now, what is the conflict for thyroid gland? So the conflict of not being fast enough to grab a desired morsel because the individual is too slow, or the conflict of not being able to get rid of undesired morsel because the individual is too slow. So this is the conflict with the thyroid. Now let me give you an example. If you are in sales and you're not able to meet a tight deadline or sales target on time, because of which you eventually get fired from the job, so you're not fast enough to grab a desired morsel, which in this case is a deadline or a sales target. According to Dr. Hemmer, the conflict is not how we define in regular terms. It's a biological conflict which is not connected anywhere to the normal conflict we talk about. And the ideal solution may not be always possible. Sometimes bringing the exact conflict or conflicts in awareness can cause or bring natural resolution or downgrade the effects of actual conflict. But there are other ways and modalities you can use for faster resolution. GNM music is one of the modalities you can use to downgrade the effects of actual conflict without resolving the real conflict. Getting more rest, getting more proteins from food. These are the few ways suggested by Dr. Hemmer to resolve or downgrade the conflict and kickstart the recovery phase. You can also use relaxing herbs, teas, plants, homeopathy, Ayurveda, acupuncture, energy work, and many other modalities for faster resolution or downgrading the conflict. But Dr. Hemmer did not advocate all these ways for recovery and resolution. He advocated only using GNM music, more rest, and proteins. Now, there is no solution which is valid for everyone when it comes to resolving the conflict. The person has to evaluate all the information and come to his or her own conclusion on what can be done or what needs to be done, which is in his or her best interest. According to GNM, if you're diagnosed with autoimmune disease like Hashimoto's disease or Graves' disease, the biological conflict is totally different. It's a powerlessness or frontal fear conflict. It's usually caused due to hanging healing. That is, the condition never fully goes through the entire resolution or healing phase. It just hangs because there are tracks or reminders that keep us in a conflict activity, and the condition never fully heals. So for thyroid gland, the conflict is being too slow to get hold or get rid of the morsel. And for thyroid nodules, it is powerlessness or frontal fear conflict. Now those who have developed high TPO and TG antibodies, it is usually the powerlessness or frontal fear conflict based on handedness and hormonal status. Now I'm not expert in German new medicine, and I'm not claiming it otherwise. If you want to access and learn authentic sources of German new medicine, I have listed down few here. The next name which comes to my mind is of Morley Robbins. He's truly an iconoclast when it comes to topic of nutrition. He doesn't just point out the problems with the allopathic practitioner, but he also points out the biggest flaws in alternative medicine practitioners through his truly classic writing style. His root cause protocol is a culmination of 9+ years of work with clients, research, and his unparalleled success stories and case studies, which is a testimony of his work being truly revered by his clients. Now, when I came to know about his approach, I was diehard skeptic, because his suggestions were exactly opposite of what the popular opinion was. But when I started implementing his suggestions in 2017, it totally changed my worldview. And I started seeing the results, I started studying his research, and I started using it on the people I work. And both of us started getting better results, and I still use his root cause protocol in my work. Now, according to Morley Robbins, there are several important things you need to take into account when evaluating your thyroid health, and you should not just look at a TSH value. There are many things, but you need to take a look at iron profile, which contains hemoglobin, serum iron, transferrin saturation and ferritin, RBC magnesium value, ceruloplasmin status, vitamin D value, and then you can take a look at thyroid profile values like T3, T4 and TSH. According to Morley Robbins, there is no such thing as medical disease. There is only metabolic dysfunction caused by mineral dysregulation. Morley thinks stress is behind everything. Here it resonates with acute conflict shock and Dr. Hemmer's work. He has also suggested many of his clients use EFT or similar modalities to deal with the stress. German New Medicine officially does not endorse any method as such. But if you look at Morley Robbins' approach, you can see the stress cascade here. Stress leads to magnesium loss, which leads to electrolyte dysfunction, which leads to energy loss, which leads to cell death, which leads to inflammation, and which leads finally to calcification and fibrosis, which is also, we believe, is a reason or one of the reasons behind hair loss. Morley Robbins also think along the similar lines of Dr. Hemmer, and he also thinks that we should take a look at the source of stress in our lives first. The third name which comes to my mind is of Dr. Caroline Dean. Morley Robbins' work is inspired by her book called Magnesium Miracle. Next one is Dr. Raymond Peet. I came across Dr. Raymond Peet back in 2015 and 2016 when I was referring to Danny Roddy's work, and I also saw some good improvement in my friend after following Raymond Peet's suggestions. Now I decided to combine the research of Dr. Raymond Peet, Morley Robbins, Dr. Caroline Dean to understand which minerals and vitamins are important for thyroid functioning. Now if you really want to know which minerals and vitamins are important, actually all vitamins and minerals are indirectly important. But if you want to take a brief look and want to see the hierarchy and want to know which minerals are usually taken into consideration when it comes to thyroid health, here are some examples: iodine, selenium, boron, copper, chromium, manganese, magnesium, vitamin A, vitamin D, zinc, and molybdenum. Now, when it comes to zinc and molybdenum, Molly Robbins suggests getting zinc from food and avoid any kind of zinc or a molybdenum supplementation, as it can affect the ceruloplasmin status. If you really look at the list, with proper testing, almost all minerals and vitamins are directly and indirectly needed for proper thyroid functioning, but definitely there is a hierarchy. Magnesium, which comes at the top, then comes vitamin A, retinol, animal-based vitamin A, then iodine, then selenium, then vitamin D. Usually, I have not seen or hardly seen people overdosing magnesium from foods or supplements. Even if they do, I have not seen any side effects except more bowel movements or drowsiness. That is not to say overdosing is okay. So as long as you choose the correct form of magnesium, there are not many side effects. Getting retinol overdose is also not very likely unless you buy beef liver capsules and consume it in excess. And even if you do, I don't think it is physically viable to do that to that much extent. Now, if you eat Brazil nuts, grains, egg yolks, fish, you usually get enough selenium. Some Brazil nuts might have very high amount of selenium, which can be problematic in some cases. If you get enough sunlight, there are no side effects of excess vitamin D production from sunlight because body can get rid of it as it is water soluble. So vitamin D supplementation is not necessary. So if you get it from sunlight and food, there is no possibility of overdose, or even if overdose happens, your body can get rid of it easily. But there is very good chance of getting iodine overdose because of several reasons. First of all, RBC selenium testing is not cheap and common. And if you want to get iodine, usually people use these four sources. Lugol's iodine is a major possibility of overdose. Seaweed or kelp. So unless you are consuming standardized capsules, there is a high possibility of overdose. Vodka remedy. So either you're not getting enough of iodine or you're getting too much of it. Iodized salt, if you're careful to use it in proportion only what is needed, and also careful about evaluating other sources of iodine in your diet, then that should not be a problem. Excess iodine can cause autoimmune thyroiditis and can worsen the symptoms and even cause more hair thinning. Now, if you really want to evaluate the thyroid functioning and want to correctly interpret the results, whether your thyroid is working optimally or not, you have to do the temperature and pulse test and not just rely on TSH value. So upon waking up in the morning, take your temperature for 5 to 7 minutes with analog thermometer. Measure your pulse using your watch. Then 20 minutes after the breakfast, using your thermometer and watch, measure your temperature and pulse again. Now around 3 p.m. in the afternoon while at rest, and at least 20 minutes after eating or drinking, use your thermometer and measure your temperature and pulse. Now, important notes which should be considered are: always measure your temperature and pulse while at rest. Measuring your temperature and pulse after physical exertion or while being stressed or rushed can affect the accuracy of the results. If you are a woman of reproductive age, then you should record your temperature and pulse during the day 2 through 4 of your menstrual cycle. You measure your temperature and pulse when you wake up 20 minutes after the breakfast and after lunch or around 3 p.m. and create a table like this. ideal temperature after waking up is 97.8, which is 36.5 degrees Celsius, and after breakfast or lunch or around 3 p.m. it should be ideally around 98.6 Fahrenheit, which means 37 degrees Celsius, considering ideal outside conditions and you're healthy from inside. Now, if you think you have developed autoimmune thyroid condition, including Hashimoto's or Graves, you should also check thyroid peroxidase antibodies and thyroglobulin antibodies. So what is the ideal TSH value? Now, I don't know, various experts have different opinions. Some say it should be less than 1 and more than 0.5. Some say it should be less than 2.5 and more than 0.5. I usually consider 0.5 to 2 as ideal range. And I also take a look at the symptoms. Will reduction in TSH value will stop and reverse my hair loss? It actually depends. Here is someone who has reduced his TSH value from 13 to 8 and gained some hairs. Look at his photo. Now here is someone who has improved hairs, but there was apparently no change in TSH value. But with reduction in TSH value, his hair became worse. Take a look at this photo. In this case of this woman, it was a toxic situation with her spouse, which also created hyperthyroid issue for her 3 years along with frontal receding. When she talked with her spouse and worked towards resolving or downgrading the conflict, she started seeing regrowth along the hairline with no diet, no supplement, no topicals, no oils, nothing on its own. And she also stopped her thyroid medication 2 months ago to this photo. Note, she has colored her hairs on the left and both photos are taken with hairs tied at the back. Now, what is the takeaway from this? First of all, focus on identifying the exact conflict or conflicts and work on resolving or downgrading them. Don't just focus on TSH value, but also do temperature and pulse tests and focus on your symptoms. If you experience better digestion, better bowel movements, better sleep, better energy, better sex drive, better mood, better appetite, better health, better hair, that is a sign of improvement, no matter if your TSH is not improving at the same rate. Look at other parameters like RBC magnesium, iron profile, vitamin D, ceruloplasmin, and see if you can get the minerals and vitamins from food. If your TSH value is more than 5, you should also get testing done for thyroid peroxidase antibody and thyroglobulin antibody. What I've seen in the last few years is those who have thyroid problems and still losing the density despite following all these suggestions, despite doing everything they can, usually have the active conflict which is keeping them hypo or hyperthyroid, or they are still using certain drugs, hormones or medication. Now, you have seen how to work on identifying and resolving the thyroid issues and fix thyroid related hair loss. And if you want to get personalized help, where I can analyze your blood work, identify psychological, environmental, dietary triggers causing hair loss and help you use corrective measures to stop the hair loss and regrow hair naturally. The more details here.